So we're just outside Edinburgh, near kind of Musselburgh, that kind of area?
Yeah, East Lothian.
Fantastic. And this is the world-famous Castle Sound Studios. Shall we go and have a little look?
The studio itself has been in this building since 1978.
Really?
So a very long time.
And this is an old school building?
This is the old Victorian school, yeah. So the building was built in about 1850. And before 78, the Castle Sound actually started in 1973 in Edinburgh, in the new town of Edinburgh, looking up to the castle, hence the name.
So, right. The name. And was there a connection with Lynn or something? Is that?
No, although very early on, Callum Malcolm, the original owner of the studio, started doing work with both originally Lynn Hi-Fi,
yeah,
and then Lynn Records. So there was never a direct connection, but there was an awful lot of work done for the record label.
Right, OK, fantastic. So this is a lovely-sounding live room that has got a lovely reflection.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of the work that we do here is acoustic-based, okay, without stating the obvious. So a lot of live recording, very often two or three or four people in this room together.
Sure.
Kind of old-fashioned in that way.
That's great. And
so obviously the room starts to play quite a large part of the overall sound of the recording. It can be carpeted as it is just now. When the carpets are lifted, it's quite a lot brighter.
I bet.
Just determined by what we're doing. But wooden floor through.
The reflection reminds me a little bit of Wigmore Hall, where it's you really hear it coming back at you, uh-huh, which I imagine string players love.
It's great for strings, yeah. But it's short. It doesn't wash them out, if you know what
no,
I mean.
Gotcha.
And over the years, we've learned how to utilise it to its, you know,
sure,
its best.
Fantastic.
I'm feeling stumbly at the moment. So
no. Shall we have a look at your some of the mics that you've got?
Sure. There's the usual suspects.
Yes.
87s, 414s, things like Royer ribbons.
I love them mainly because they look like lightsabers.
Amazing. Yeah. Microphones and all manner of things, from guitar amps to strings. I was using one a couple of days ago on a flute, and it was by far the best thing.
I always found it extraordinary. You'd never usually think of putting a ribbon in front of a really loud guitar amp, but they can
take this, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, on jazz records, I'll very often at an angle put it in front of a kick drum,
really?
And it sounds unbelievable. Well, it sounds just like the drum, whereas a lot of mics you put on a bass drum that doesn't have a hole cut in it, and it just doesn't represent the actual sound of the drum at all. But these do, and they can take
it. That's a good tip.
I've yet to blow one up. So. Nice.
And you've been trying.
I've been trying really hard for years, yeah. So Neumann TLM 170s, which again are fairly neutral sounding mics. Where do we go? Things like... Oops. Cloud 44A, which is based on the old RCA ribbon mics.
Sure.
Darker than a Royer sounding, but lovely on strings. When you want things to be, I hate the word, but when you want things to be warm and round,
yeah,
they just do it.
So it's cloud. Never
cloud,
heard of
them. Yeah. I don't know much about them either, to be perfectly honest. I believe they started servicing originally old RCA mics and then have started making them themselves.
Oh, wow.
And like the Royers that I've got, these are phantom powered, so the choice of preamp things becomes a lot less critical.
Right, I understand.
A company called Flea, these are, I've got a pair of C12s.
Oh, I've always wanted to talk to someone who are they?
Are they? Do they?
You know what?
I don't have a pair of C12s, so I can't make that direct comparison. But I think they're incredible.
Right.
I love them as drum overheads. Absolutely love them as the main stereo pair on a piano.
Okay.
Vocal mics, they're beautiful. Acoustic guitar, female vocals are excellent.
Because I don't think there is better than a C12 for a female.
No.
I mean, obviously, everyone's vocals
depends on the singer.
But as a generalisation.
Yeah. But no, really, really lovely. Acoustic guitar. Trying to think, what else have you used them on? that's the kind of main things that I've used them on. And in the same world, is a Soundelux 251, which are, they're now a company called Bok. This one's actually been modified to have an original CK12 capsule in it from a 251. So without spending obscene amounts of money, it's as close as I can get to the original thing. It's a very similar world technically to the C12. Slightly, the sort of presence peak is even higher on these.
Okay.
So it's real air. There's not a hint of harshness or anything.
Fantastic. And have you found the fleas from a kind of servicing point of view? Because I think this is one of the things that I've been on the search for a C12 for about 10 years now, but people say one of the difficulties is maintenance and stuff.
Of originals?
Yeah.
Yeah, I would imagine so. I mean, those have been utterly perfect.
Right.
Not a thought. One of the valves, I actually changed the pair at the same time because one of them had gone a little bit noisy. Yeah. And just kind of threw money at that, to be honest, you know, got the best thing that I could at the time. But no, I mean, I'm not really in a position, well, firstly, I'm not really in a position to buy original C12s, but then the whole maintenance issue, and it even comes down to like the desk next door and stuff.
Sure.
You know, it's hard to maintain old gear nowadays.
Yeah, it becomes part of the overhead, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
An increased overhead for the studio.
Absolutely.
And more.
And particularly being like out with London, where most of the maintenance guys are and all that. You know, for example, if the desk goes down here, you're talking, you can be shut for a week.
Yeah.
So it just can't happen, basically.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
So that I suppose dictates some of the choices, and original C12s and things, they're just so expensive.
Yes.
You're competing against collectors nowadays, as opposed to just other studios.
It's inflated the marketplace.
Yeah. Yeah. The only thing that I haven't found a modern equivalent for...
I was going to say, the last time I was here, imagine there was a beautiful Sony.
This is a C37A.
It is so beautiful. That is the most perfect colour for kit.
It's just fantastic, yeah. There isn't, from anything that I've discovered, a modern-day equivalent of what this does.
Okay.
I've used this on everything. Again, I mean, it's relatively dark sounding, but beautiful on the right acoustic guitar, on the right vocal, there's nothing better. I dared, because somebody had told me about it, I dared about a week ago to use it on a snare drum on a jazz album, which made me slightly nervous. But it did sound incredible, actually.
Right.
Beautiful depth and things.
I think the aesthetic of that, for me, is perfection.
Yeah, I totally agree. I love the fact that the polar pattern is changed by a screwdriver.
Yes, that's what you don't want.
And there's actually a moving mechanism inside that makes it omni or cardioid.
Brilliant, fantastic. Do you use the booths much?
All the time.
Right.
The majority of work that I do is, I mean, stylistically it can be anything from quite a lot of sort of trad music, a lot of singer-songwriter kind of things, a lot of jazz records, acoustic generally. So people utilize this place because there's a nice sounding live room. There are also the booths. Everybody's got eye contact with everybody. And the vast majority of albums that I'm involved in start with three or four or five or six people playing together at the same time. And those are the bones of it.
Right.
Now, obviously there's a whole process after that, but in essence, a lot of the work for the sound of the album and the performances is done in the setup and making sure everybody's comfortable and can see each other properly.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's rare that I'm working with a click to be, you know.
That's just so refreshing to hear. No, it really is.
Well,
that's absolutely...
a lot of the music, it would be ludicrous to work with a click. You know, it doesn't make sense because the emotional content is the movement.
Of course.
And these people are out playing, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 days a week with each other. So the movement is a large part of it.
Yeah.
So I see my job not as kind of saying, all right, well, this has got to be now metronomic for no apparent reason.
No.
It's making people comfortable and getting it to sound the way I perceive it and the way that they want it.
And the great thing about not working with a click is it becomes that much harder to edit. And where there's a lessening of a temptation to edit, it's about capturing the performance.
Yeah, I mean, there's still a lot of editing goes on, but probably more in the way that music's always been edited with a razor blade. You know, it's like, okay, that take up to bar 20 was amazing, but then let's chop to here. And generally speaking, tempos are okay. Yeah. You nudge the edit around, you sometimes move the drums a few beats after the bar, and somehow it feels better like that going through the edit. So there is a lot of editing, but in a different way.
Absolutely.
It's not like, okay, that chorus was good, let's just repeat that four times.
It's not gonna work.
Never.
No.
More over the whole band.
Gotcha. Now, something that really excited me first time I came to visit you was that I believe Blue Nile recorded here, is that correct?
The Blue Nile have recorded all of their albums here, yes.
Now, down south, they have a cult following down south.
Yeah.
But I think they were notoriously shy, weren't they? So they were big in Scotland, but it's more of a collector's thing down south. That's what I find.
Yeah, I mean, I think they were always very critically acclaimed. And they took their time to make albums. And maybe that gives the perception of being shy. I mean, their albums took years to make.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, they were in here, as far as I understand, week after week after week, year after year. And then they would decide to take 6 months off and then come back and redo. It was a slow process of development, but the albums are incredible.
Do you do about equal amount of tracking and mixing or...?
In the studio?
Yeah.
Yes. It just seems to go through waves of one or the other. I mean, at the moment, I've been doing a lot of recording. Mm-hmm. Things being the way they are in the industry nowadays, sometimes I'm purely recording something and then it's taken away and worked on elsewhere, or people are sit with a Pro Tool system in their bedroom and work on it. But the other side of that is that, well, obviously there's a certain proportion of projects that I see through from beginning to end. And there's also a good amount of mixing work of projects that I haven't ever heard, from all over, actually.
Right.
I seem to do quite a lot of sort of Celtic-y projects, but those can come from the States or from Australia. There's a chap that I do quite a lot of work for over there. They just send over the Pro Tools files, generally a rough mix with them, and I do what I do.
Well,
basically.
Let's see where you do that, because it's a wonderful environment.
Mm.
Great stuff. So I guess we should start with the board. And I'm seeing these in more and more places. I think Valguier has one of these. And we did a Cribs recently, and they had one of these as well. So it's a solid. It's an SSL...
It's an SSL, effectively 24 fader desk. This is the 948, so each of the analog channels is stereo, as opposed to a traditional analog console. So stereo EQ on every channel. The way it integrates with Pro Tools then becomes incredibly fast and instinctive, really to the point where you stop thinking whether something is being done within Pro Tools or in the analog world. It really does become one system, for me anyway. Before we had this, I think I got this in about 2010 or 2011 maybe. Before this was here, there was the original AWS 900, which was 24 mono channels.
Gotcha.
But same basic concept. So at the press of a button, it can be a Pro Tools controller or an analog desk. And I love it, I have to say. I'm really familiar with it now. There's nothing better on the market, I don't think, for what I do.
Well, it's interesting kind of spotting it in these various different studios. And I think that there's this really weird thing that goes on in the kind of industry press, which is in the box or out of the box. And it's like, well, that's kind of primitive thinking. I think it's all about a hybrid way of working, yeah, these days. And this seems to be quite a good bridge for that kind of way of working.
To the point where, as I say, you just don't think about whether something's in the box or out the box.
Sure.
Although for the majority of projects, I probably think in my own head, I'm mixing analog. I'm absolutely using plugins for their strengths. I'm submixing stuff within Pro Tools. If it's a project that I've not been involved in and I'm mixing it, I'll basically try to make sense of the session within Pro Tools. So if there's an acoustic guitar that has five mics on it, which happens, I'll effectively try and subgroup those within Pro Tools. So that it's coming down one stereo channel on the analog side of it.
Sure.
So I do not think about in the box, out the box, whatever.
Yeah.
They're just tools at the end of the day, and
they make you work. For me, it's not just about the sonics, is it? It's actually just about the experience and the way that you work. And you know, I always just go on about the thing that's really difficult to do with these is we have opposable thumbs. So that action in a computer is really
impossible.
Difficult to do. And that, when you're doing sound, you know, filter, cutoff, whatever, you know, it's an important part of the process.
Yeah, and I find, where I was kind of saying this to you earlier on, when I'm mixing a project that I've never heard or haven't been involved in the recording part of it, I almost always will put it out on the desk. I won't mix literally in the box.
Right.
Purely because of that, because on the desk allows me to be instinctive. It allows me to do things without thought, if that
or
makes sense.
Or being told what you're doing. But because you, with the problem with plugins, is you're always looking at the dBs and the hertz.
Absolutely.
And then you suddenly have that stupid thing of, well, I'd be told off for doing that because that's surely 14K is far too high.
Yeah. The SSL EQ I know so well, and I literally won't look at it. You know, it's such a tactile experience. I just do it and use my ears, hopefully. And
you don't find out what you did until you recall it.
Well, exactly, yeah. And sometimes you recall the EQ on the desk and you're going, bloody hell, is that really what I did? And I would never be able to get in that situation with plugins, even though that is what the sound needed, because the kind of other side of my brain would be saying, exactly as you were saying, no, you can't do that, you know. I don't want that baggage. I find things, if I've recorded something and I'm happy with it and everybody's happy with it, I do find it much easier to base things more in the box as opposed to out the box.
Yeah.
But for projects where I'm just having to be instinctive and get things more into shape in the way I imagine them, I rely on the desk and outboard to get me there.
Amazing. That's very handsome, that.
It's
I think I've seen these at trade fairs and stuff.
Yeah.
But what is it?
Shadow Hill's mastering compressor, but the word mastering is probably slightly... that's not really the way I think of it. I think of it as a bus compressor, either the stereo bus or a drum bus. It's two compressors. Each channel has got two compressors, so it starts with an optical compressor, like an LE2 or something like
yes.
that, followed by a discrete compressor, more like an SSL-style bus compressor. And they're always in that order. And you can meter... you can have the left meter being the optical side and the right meter being the discrete side. When I'm mixing, if something's drum heavy, the material, I almost always go to this. The way that you can pull the drums into the track is incredible.
Right.
And then you bypass it and the drums sound like they're 10 dB too loud, but it doesn't sound smashed, you know. It does something amazing.
Are these stepped as well?
Everything's stepped, right. So it's completely recallable, which obviously in this day and age, annoying as it sometimes is, people are so used to pressing a button on their computer that they expect things to be recallable. Okay. But recallable switched analog isn't cheap, you know, otherwise everybody would do it.
Yeah. Yeah, I bet. Well, it's the same with the culture vulture down there. That's stepped, isn't it?
That's indented. Some of it is, anyway, yeah. Okay. It's not quite as recallable, but it's fine. If you know, can get close enough for distortion.
Brilliant. And I know a couple of studios that use these and swear by them.
Really the Phoenix.
It. Yeah.
I love it. I really love it. I think it's actually what, although it's probably not what most people use it for, I think it's one of the best vocal compressors that I've used. Certainly for a lot of the things that I do, which probably aren't screamy and shouty.
Okay.
You really hear the tone of it.
Yeah.
And there's an awful lot of nonsense talked about that, I think. But that unit, you really do hear it. It has a very smooth kind of upper mid-range. So for somebody that's a little bit peaky in their voice, the compression itself is great, but just the tone of the box is amazing. It just softens out 3K,
okay.
That kind of thing.
Right, gotcha.
It also has a sidechain filter on it, so you can keep the bottom end of a vocal at more out of the compression, which in itself starts to warm it up. A lot of people use it as a stereo mix compressor. I've probably not got into it as much for that, but then that's maybe because I've got other options. I end up using my Verimew, my Manly Verimew, when this isn't appropriate.
Yeah.
On things that aren't drum heavy and are more legato,
sure.
I use the Verimew. That, a lot of that is because I've been using one for the last 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I just know it. I know I can basically set it without even hearing it almost.
Sure.
You know, I know exactly what it does. And I love the sound of it.
Should have a little look down here.
Sure.
Then. So that's the Verimew there.
That's the one at the top there.
Excellent.
There's a Fatso. That's a slightly different version of the Fatso, but made by the same people that make the Distressors.
Okay, gotcha.
Which again has a really interesting warmth function. Which is basically like a high frequency limiter.
And the ever faithful 33609s.
Pair of 33609s. I actually had three of them at one point. I love them.
Yeah.
There's a lot of nice stuff in here. If I only had 33609s, I would be happy.
They're great ticklers, aren't they? Just very musical.
Absolutely. And I mean, I'll track through them all the time. But at like 1.5:1 or 2:1, and you know, if it's showing 4 dB of compression, that's a lot for me. But if you take it out, the whole thing is totally different, you know.
Okay.
Again, 1.5:1, 100 or 400 millisecond recovery, and not doing very much, but actually it makes a huge difference, I think.
And I see at the bottom here is a very smart.
There's the Bricasti there, which is kind of the main thing that I use, I suppose. I don't even need to say very much about it. They're so brilliant for acoustic music. At the back of the room as well, I've got sort of my strangely 80s reverb.
This is your
collection.
80s rack.
with the exception of
it's all wired in, though.
Oh, it's all wired in, yep. It's all normal to the desk, actually.
Brilliant.
So I've got a PCM70, Lexicon 300.
So I like those for small rooms. I don't know if you agree with Lexicon and small rooms.
Well, these probably sit on this on similar, if not the same, settings all the time. So PCM70 is on tiled room, small room.
Yeah.
This is actually saying chamber at the moment, but Studio A is another small room, which is amazing.
Yeah.
The Rev 5 gets used for whatever occasionally.
Yeah.
The M5000 still has a certain thing that, although they ported all of that, I mean, this is going back years, ported it all over to the 6000, it doesn't sound the same.
How interesting.
So I still use that for, and it's just because I've used it for years and years.
Sure.
There's just a few settings that are go-tos that I know. And the PCM96,
takes the longest to boot.
Bloody 4 years. That's a modern reverb like the Bricasti.
I
don't love it as much as the Bricasti, I have to say.
That's interesting.
All of these things and the Bricasti and the TC, I feel like I've found their home for me. Yeah. The PCM96, it does some beautiful things. I don't find myself at, like, it has a go-to thing that I'll automatically just go to. Yeah. Maybe one day I will.
Sure.
So those are all hardwired to the desk.
And even also, the line six?
No. Definitely
well
not.
Done.
No, that's just filling the space in there. Right?
let's finish before we sit down.
Sure.
On the monitoring side. Don't know. So ATC are wonderful.
Yeah, these are ATC 45As. Before these were here, there were a pair of Lin monitors, which Lin dipped their toe into making studio monitors. And it didn't last. However, when they were originally building them, and this is going back maybe to 2000 or something like that, they'd bring a lot of the prototypes through here to try out and work on them. And we ended up with a pair, and I did love them. However, they were kind of reaching the end of their life, and Lin wouldn't support them anymore.
Okay.
and stuff. So I was in the position where I had to try a few other things. And so I did, and people were great, really helpful in sending stuff up. These were probably the thing that sat most comfortably to me relative to the Lins. They're not particularly flattering. There were some monitors that I tried where you put on everything and everything sounded really amazing.
Yeah.
But that for me isn't what I want. I want things to sound a bit crap, actually, and then to have to work to make them sound better. The Lins were quite high mid-forward, and I'd become really used to that. So some monitors sounded really scooped to me, although they probably didn't to anybody else.
Sure.
So these sort of lived in a comfortable world for me. And actually, since I've had them, I'm finding the mids easy to work with. I think the top end's beautiful, but the improvement for me is the bottom end. I think these are more real world than the Lins were. The Lins went down obscenely to like 19 hertz or something, which is fine. But, you know, occasionally I would take things out to my car and what sounded incredible in here and massive, but it was like, I can't bloody hear it, you know.
Yeah.
So these are a bit, you know, when you get the bottom end right on these, it translates incredibly well, I
Excellent.
Think. I find them easier over long periods as well, these. So I've been really, really happy with them. The stereo imaging is incredible. Offsetting something in Pro Tools to two left or two right, you can hear it on these, which I was astonished by.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So I'm not personally a person that has a pair of NS10s and a pair of these and a pair of Auratones or whatever. It's never made sense to me. The concept makes complete sense, but I've never been able to get my brain to work like that in the
sure.
middle of a mix. I just find myself feeling lost. So I just get used to something and work on it. So I start on these and finish on these. The only thing I very occasionally use is a little Pure radio.
Gotcha.
Which I just have off the kind of headphone output of the desk, which was actually given to me as a present. It was with a guy that I was working with who sort of swore by this, you know.
Uh-huh.
So at the end of the session, when he was taking his away, he had bought me one, which was very nice.
Again, I'm familiar with those. I have to check them out. So how long have you been here?
Personally?
Yeah.
I started working here in 1994.
Okay.
When I was at school, I had, in those days, like a little four-track cassette machine and a DX something keyboard that I'd saved up my pocket money for, you know. And then we had these careers interviews and they said, what do you want to do? And I said, I want to go and work in a recording studio. And they said, no, you can't do that. That doesn't feature in our list. So I just I phoned up every studio I could find in the yellow pages in those days. And eventually I found a studio that would take me on for work experience. So that was in a studio that's now sadly long gone in Edinburgh. So I went there to work for a week just making tea. And then I went back at the end of my fifth year of school. I went back for the whole summer holidays and worked properly, you know, like still making tea. And about 3 or 4 days before I was supposed to go back for my last year of school, the guy offered me a job. So So that was me. I left school and started, and it was good actually. It was there were quite a lot of adverts and things, which meant that every 2 or 3 hours you were working with new people, and it was fast. And as a 16-year-old or whatever, fairly shy person, you very quickly learned how to communicate with people of all different types and things. So it was quite a good education. So I worked there for a while, and then worked at a bigger studio in Edinburgh, where at that time, like Wet 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 were in there doing an album, and Van Morrison was in, and various other things. So that was a different, a totally different experience again. And then through sort of mutual clients, I suppose, I got to know Callum, who ran Castle Sound, owned and had started Castle Sound. And so in 94, I came out and started working with him. He had, from the back of projects like the Blue Nile, was getting more and more requests to go elsewhere and produce albums. So the studio potentially was becoming, owning a studio was becoming a little bit of a liability for him, actually, because he was, you know, could be anywhere, but he still had the bills to pay. So I came out and was doing the sort of day-to-day sessions, and he was wherever. So that's how I started here. And then in 97, Callum did eventually decide that he didn't want a studio anymore. So I went and worked with a guy called Fish from Marillion, who we were talking about earlier, and worked at his studio, which was a beautiful place, for 18 months. And then a musician that had worked in the studio a lot decided to reopen it. So I came back like a shot because I loved this place. Mm-hmm. And basically worked in conjunction with him until 2010, when I took the business over myself. So that's been an education, you know. Yes. I'm certainly not a great businessman. I'm too good at spending money on gear.
But that is my next question. You know, there are so many, as we know, there are so many studios that are have fallen by the wayside, and so many studios still closing. Mm-hmm. Some have survived and some are thriving. What are your thoughts behind it? I mean, this has been here for a long time, and there was a hiatus, but
yeah,
you know, what's the secret?
I absolutely don't know the answer to that, to be honest. I mean, I think that from a purely business point of view, I keep my overheads as low as they can be. I mean, it's like we were talking about mix and desk and things earlier on. I would love to have a Duality or a Neve equivalent or whatever. But the level of commitment is so huge, and the monthly outgoings would be so huge, that it would only take 1 or 2 quiet months for me not to have a business anymore. Yeah. So I guess it's about pitching the investment relative to the work. The studio rate, they're never ever going to go up now. You know, I mean, it's as much as I can do to keep it at the same level year on year. So I guess it's about finding the right combination of equipment and the building and everything like that. I mean, I think I'm very lucky with this particular building. It's an attractive place. It sounds great and all that. But I'm afraid I don't really know the secret. I've been doing, personally now, been doing this so long that a lot of the people that I work with come because of what I can offer.
Sure, absolutely.
Which is amazing, and I feel totally privileged. Sometimes it can be hard because it's not like I can just get a freelancer to come in and do the work for me. It becomes quite a personal relationship that you have with the people that you're working with. But I don't know, just pitching the place correctly for the businesses, for the work that's out there, I guess, is the only
thing. Well, it's very interesting. You mentioned about, you know, well, you could get one of these desks in, but if it goes down, you know. And I was actually at British Grove doing a really big, possibly the biggest French film in recent years, and the desk went down. The motherboard went down.
Yeah.
And we had to wait for 2 weeks to come back. And I think, you know, I mean, obviously British Grove is a different business model.
Absolutely.
But that could be devastating.
And I know how that feels. I mean, before any SSLs, and before that, we had for a short while, there was a Sony Digital desk in here. But before all of that, there was an old Neve, which was beautiful. But exactly the same thing happened. One of the six power supplies blew up and the place was closed for a week. Now, you can have a situation where there are, you know, 15 string players that have been hired for that week. Who pays them? It becomes a complete nightmare. Which is why desks like this, they keep working. They're brilliantly designed. And for a business like mine, it's ideal. And that's not taking into account the fact that it also sounds great as well.
Absolutely. You know. Brilliant stuff. We had a fantastic interview earlier this week with Patrick Doyle, who talked about the heritage. One presumes Scotland's a big place because, you know, the landmass is not insignificant. But actually, when you look at what the population is, it's a very, very small country.
Yeah.
Which then, when I look at the acts that have come out of Scotland, it is a pretty incredible thing.
Absolutely.
Really. And what do you think's behind that? The drummer of the Chili Peppers I worked with once, and he said it was something to do with the fact that the weather was shit, so there was nothing better to do than practice, sit indoors practicing your guitars. What's your take on it? Because in Scotland, it isn't just about a musical tradition like it is down south of rock and roll and the American influence. There is also this amazing folk heritage as well that ties in.
Absolutely.
So I'll stop speaking. And what's your take?
One of the things that I notice up here is that, now you can correct me if I'm wrong, but like you're saying, there's the rock and roll thing or the folk thing or whatever. There is so much integration between all of these worlds up here. So, you know, pop bands are working with folk musicians who are working with jazz musicians. So it's like a melting pot. And all of these people are involved in different projects. So, you know, like Chris Stout that you were talking about earlier on, I've worked with him on jazz records. I've worked with him on very traditional music records.
Yeah.
And I'm sure he's been involved in pop things as well, you know. So... I think the lines that divide and the snobbery that can exist doesn't really exist up here. And, you know, you go out to a gig and you, not that I do that much because I'm too old now, but you know, I meet people from all these different worlds going to see the most obscure music, you know. So those divisional lines just don't seem to exist up here. And I think it's amazing because you end up with combinations of people working together that you never would in other places. No. Maybe that's because it is too small a world up here for people to pigeonhole themselves.
Sure.
You know.
I've lived here for a year now. Mm. The pride is incredible and it's wonderful to witness. And I take my kids to school every morning and you hear bagpipes being practiced and snare drums being played. It is really quite incredible to witness. And I think that one of the first things that I found staggering was 2 weeks after moving up, we were invited to a ceilidh. And a bunch of shoegazing, you know, kids with the hair, you know, not wanting to speak to adults, walked through the door, kicked their shoes off and were up. You know, they're kind of at the age where down south, you know, doing folk dancing in front of your friends... Uh-huh. You know, and that's an incredible thing to witness.
Yeah, but it's the mentality. I mean, it's like you're saying folk dancing as if it was a horrible, you know, as if it was like something that your grandparents would have done. But it's just part of normal life. You know, it's people going out having fun and it's great. And and that melting pot of the shoegazing people being in that environment then creates... amazing music, you know, because they're taken from all of these things. And there's been such a massive resurgence in folk music, traditional music. But that can be... I mean, I worked with a guy who sadly died, but a chap called Martin Bennett, who has become very acclaimed since he died. But he was completely into sort of dance music culture and DJ culture. But he grew up playing bagpipes and fiddle and everything, and combined all of these worlds and got people in from every, you know, different musical genre, and created amazing albums of, you know, loops and looping pipes and chopping them up and all that. And it just feels normal to me to take from everything, you know, and that's what the vast majority of projects that I'm involved in, if somebody said, what is it? I wouldn't know how to answer that, you know. Is it a folk record? Not really, because it's got a saxophone on it, you know. Is it a jazz record? Not really, because it's got fiddles on it, you know, and it can have, you know, two electric guitarists and a drum kit. So, very blessed up here, I think.
Yeah, absolutely, I agree. Well, Stuart, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. Thanks so much
Thank you for
your time. It's absolutely brilliant. Cheers.
Thank you.